Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is Dorothy May Mercer for Authors and Publishers Speak TV. Tonight we have a fascinating gentleman by the name of Bill Lindsay, and he's written a book. I'd like to hear all about it. I just met you, Bill, so I'm anxious to get acquainted. Tell me how you got to this point.
Well, I've always thought about writing a book, and I always liked the paranormal and stories about Bigfoot and aliens and such like that. And about 30 years ago, I was in a library looking for something interesting, and I happened across a story about a fellow called Springheel Jack, and he was a English folklore figure from the 1800s, about the mid 1800s, and he was a type of a villain that would leap out at night on people and scare them, and he didn't really do, you know, he didn't murder people or anything like that, but he was just kind of a mischievous character, and his distinguishing feature was that he could jump over walls and buildings whenever they tried to catch him, and he could get away real easily. And he had a few other traits also. He had was said to have glowing red eyes, and he also had some kind of claws or metallic objects on his hands.
Oh, come on.
And he also breathed a blue type of flames into his victim's eyes and gassed them. So, you know,
oh my goodness.
So he created all kinds of havoc over in England, and there was like for 70 years there was sightings of him, and I think about the last sighting was about in 1904.
Yeah, and this is a real character, right? Somebody.
Yeah, a lot of people thought that he was made up by the press. And he was just, panic. People panic when they were attacked, and they made all kinds of stories up. But his
hysterical, right?
Yeah.
Kind of like the Loch Ness monster. A legend.
Yeah.
So you heard about this guy. Then what'd you do?
Well, like I said, it was 30 some years ago, and it kind of brewed in my head, and one day it just hit me. I thought, well, why can't I make up a couple of characters and put them in England in the 1800s and have them find his remains in an old chimney and kind of go from there. So I developed a couple of characters that were kind of like partners, and they actually find his remains in an old chimney and start using his equipment that is found with the corpse. So they in fact bring his legend back to life by, you know, doing mischievous acts, and so they kind of perpetuate his legend around 1899.
Oh my goodness. He sounds so terrifying, Bill.
Yeah. I don't think I'd want to meet a character like that could jump 20 feet in the air and had glowing red eyes and claws and spouted a flame, so.
Oh, boy. It's incredible. And so then you probably embellished the character just a little bit yourself, huh?
I mainly had fun with the fact of these two characters trying to use his equipment when they don't really know what it is they're using, and you know, there's, I tried to thread a lot of humor through the book and added some characters who were really on the trail of Springheel Jack, trying to bring him in, and I had fun with the two characters and what they were going through, and just, you know, something about two two regular guys, and they find this discovery, and they're like, what are we going to do with this, you know? So they're trying to make some kind of a benefit from it. But anyway,
do they get into trouble?
Yes, they do. Eventually, yes. So.
Uh-oh. So they... You don't have to tell me to give away the ending, but you got me intrigued. So where did they find all this? They found the bones. I understand that. But where did they find his equipment?
Well, the premise of the story was that I thought, you know, the sightings of Spring-Heeled Jack tapered off, and I was thinking, well, maybe he was trying to get away or something, and he got caught in this chimney and couldn't get away. So maybe that explains what happened to the guy. And then, you know, these two characters come in and they take over from there.
Yep. Oh, that's crazy. So you have a job and you work, so where do you find time to write?
Well, I have a 16-year-old son, and he, over the summers, he usually goes away on vacation, and so I kind of seized the opportunity with him being gone, and you know, my evenings were free, and so I had this idea, and I just kind of had a few weeks, and I just said I'm going to do this, and I used my evenings, and you know, we just worked through the process and found a publisher, and it all came out. So
you found a publisher. Are you self-published?
Yeah.
So how long has your book been out?
It's been out since September of 2010.
Mm-hmm. And where can we find it?
It's on a lot of the major book sites. It's on Amazon, Barnes & Noble, and my publisher, Ex Libris, out of Bloomington, Indiana. And it's on a lot of other online sites. I keep a supply of books myself and try to get out every once in a while and peddle a few.
Where do you go? Tell other authors that are listening.
Yeah, that's not, you know, I'm trying to figure that process out myself, but I had one book signing, and it was interesting because it was at our hometown library, and I'm also in an arts council, and we put on plays, and I've acted in several of their plays, and so I had some of my fellow actors pose as characters for my book, and we had an English tea at our hometown library, and I had characters from the book, and everybody had fun. They were in character, and they, you know, mingled with the people coming in, and it was all quite a deal. We had a lot of fun with that.
Oh, that's interesting. I've heard all kinds of ideas of how to sell books, and that's the first time I've heard of that. Good idea.
Yeah.
It got you some publicity. You just have to keep working at it, right? Any other?
Yeah, you have to. I had another book signing set up for, and the bookstore having to go out of business before I could have my signing there. So,
oh,
but I had a booth set up at the Red Skelton Festival they have over in Vincennes. I had a book signing over there, and that was interesting. It was during the Parade of a Thousand Clowns, so I had a lot of clowns hanging around.
Wow.
Pulling pranks and stuff.
It's hard to find places to set up your table that you don't have to pay. Did you have to pay to set it up?
Yeah. I also had some artwork that I usually, in the past, that's what I did. I would pick out festivals, and I do sculpture and painting and drawings, and I've also created a few life-size fiberglass figures, and so I've had them in different places in the immediate area.
So this art that's on the wall behind you, are those some of your works?
No, these aren't mine. No, I've got some of mine in other rooms in the house. But.
I see. So what are your plans from here on out as far as your writing is concerned?
Well, I have the sequel to this book.
Oh.
I haven't written it. I've written part of it, only a couple chapters, and I'm trying to work some time where I can actually sit down and do some writing, but it's kind of difficult. We just moved here recently, and we're still in the process of moving, and I'm working about every day, so it's kind of tough to be able to sit down and write, but I'm hoping to have an opening coming up here somewhere.
It is hard to find time. You know, is the name of your book Spring Hill Jack?
The name of my book is The Bones of Jack.
Oh, okay. You show me the, might as well show me the book.
Okay. I can find it up here. Probably can't see it. It's got a little top hat in the back and there's a rat.
I can't see that. But you know, that's a memorable color cover. I don't think anybody's going to forget that. Tip it a little bit so we don't get the reflection.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I wish you luck with your endeavor, and encourage all of the writers out there to get busy and find time to write, and look up your friend Bill Lindsay anytime. He'd be happy to sign a book for you, I'm sure.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I can do that.
Any last words before we sign off, Bill?
Just really, it takes discipline to write like that. I mean, you know, just to find, there's so many things you have to tend to during the day, and that's, it really took a lot of discipline for me to say, okay, I need to do this, I have to put this down, and I have to write at least a little every night. So, you know, you can't just sit down and do it all at once, so you have to do little bits. It's just like a lot of things in life, you know, you have to work at it, you have to nibble at it, and finally, after a while, it'll come to fruition for you.
Bill, tell me, did you have the whole plot all planned out in your mind so that you just had to follow that structure, or did you just let it flow?
Yeah, I had the beginning of it and the end of it is what I had, so I really had to... And I added characters. You know, when I got to a certain point, I thought, well, I need somebody here, somebody who's after trying to catch Spring Heel Jack. And so I had to add him, so I had to add some of the bad guys, you know. My two characters are kind of the good guys. And then, you know, when it's like a, I think of it like a tree branch, you know. You start with the stalk or whatever, and then you branch out, and you got ideas going this way, and they give a couple of ideas, and it just kind of turns into a tree. So I guess the more branches you got, and the more little little mini branches you got, it makes it more interesting.
Yeah. Okay, well, thank you very much for visiting with us, Bill, Lindsay, and we'll look for your book in the bookstores and around, and I wish you all the best of everything.
Okay, thanks a lot. I really appreciate this.
You're very welcome. So this is Dorothy Mae Mercer signing off for Authors and Publishers Speak, and we'll see you again soon. Good night, all.